Hello, welcome, beautiful beings. Zach, can we just go back to gallery view real quick? I just want to invite us to take each other in a little bit as we arrive. So yeah, as always, please do check that you've got everything you need to be comfortable for the next little while. This is our session where we're mostly meditating with maybe a little bit of input from myself and Balajit, and maybe a chance for some inquiry if there's time. So I want to invite us to just look at the wonderful, magical display of, as Balajit says, blaze of color and light and shadow and form on the screen, each other, the retreat. This beloved retreat body. Yeah, really appreciating all of you and how you're showing up here, your practice, your commitment, your intentions, your love, your journeys. And then let's just do a little bit of orienting. So for some reason, I always privilege the right side when I start orienting. So I'm going to do something different and privilege the left side. So maybe turn in the direction that you wouldn't normally turn in if you've noticed that you tend to privilege one side over the other. And we're just going to very slowly take in our environment. And we can do this with the eyes while also noticing sounds, felt sensations in the body, the mood we're in right now, how we are as we're arriving, thoughts, emotions floating through. And when you've gotten all the way around to the other side, just very gently coming back to center. We're just going to close our eyes for a moment and just notice the internal landscape. Maybe even naming a few things we can feel here. So I can feel my hands touching, contact between the fingers and palm of the hand. I can feel air coming and going through the nostrils. And as my shoulders drop down, I can feel the softness of my shirt against the skin. So what can you feel in the body? And then gently opening the eyes, and we'll just do one more round of orienting, this time looking in the other direction first. And slowly making our way around, just really taking in all the forms, colors, shapes, light, shadow, movement of our environment. Noticing any effect this has on the system. And then this time when we return to center, we'll just take each other in again. And just notice any difference from when we first did this a couple minutes ago, both in terms of what you're noticing on the screen and also what you're noticing in yourself. There may not be any difference, which is fine as well. But if there is, just noticing that. Yeah. Good. So in this session, we thought it might be useful to just do a whole session around, just sitting, because this is also a core practice in our tradition. So we've been, mostly the intention in these sessions has been to weave all of the input into how we might work in the mindfulness of breathing and the metta bhavana. Within the core practices of Charana, the mindfulness of breathing, the metta bhavana, and just sitting. And we've been focusing mostly on mindfulness of breathing and metta bhavana. So we wanted to give a good chunk of time now to just sitting. And I'll just say a few things by way of introduction. And then I'll guide us in a practice. And then we'll have a 15-minute break at about 10 to the hour. And we'll come back at 5 past the next hour, whatever that hour is for you. And Balajit will take the reins and we'll keep going a bit more, just sitting. So Zach, you can feel free to spotlight me again. So yeah, I think it was a couple of days ago that I'm actually going to go back to gallery view because I like to see everyone while I'm talking. I think it was just I can't remember anymore. You know how that is on retreat where you stop remembering when, what happened where, and who said what, when. sense of time. So I think I was talking about how we can, I've found it helpful in my practice at some point that there was this kind of subtle shift from sort of imagining that I, when I got distracted, that I was bringing my awareness back to the breath. And the shift was that it was like I just, when I noticed distraction, it was as if the breath just came into awareness on its own. I didn't have to apply much effort to make that happen. So it was sort of a sense of like, oh yeah, the body just knows what to do. And there is awareness. There's awareness in that moment of noticing I was distracted. Awareness is already there. There's nothing that I have to do. And just appreciating the clarity of that awareness. And I was suggesting that the breath was a gateway into the body and into how we might render the body conscious and render all of what arises and passes in experience conscious. So in the same way, so in just sitting, where we're letting go of directing the mind and attending to any one aspect of our experience and opening to the fullness, all of what's arising in the 6 senses, all of what's coming and going, we can also notice how just like the breath is arising and passing, coming and going, in and out in awareness, so is all of experience. So are sounds, so are visual sensations, so are physical sensations in the body, tingling, bubbling, warmth, coolness, heaviness, lightness, expansion, tightness, contraction, numbness, and on and on. And so are thoughts and emotions, images, projections, ruminations, replaying something that happened in the past, fantasizing about something that might happen in the future, planning, worrying. And even more subtly, thoughts of the present, you know, like maybe there's a little bit of a narrator labeling experience, which can be helpful. So we don't just going back to, you know, the different ways of working that Viveka so helpfully front loaded the retreat with. So, it's, you know, labeling can be helpful just to get an initial sense of what's actually happening. And then even in just sitting, we can see what it's like to drop the label, drop the conceptual overlay, and just drop right into direct experience as it is before even the need to know what's here steps in and tries to manage and control experience in some way. So one of the things that I've also really appreciated on my own meditation journey is just getting, feeling more and more able to, and actually to bring in the language of resilience, you know, like building my own internal resilience and confidence to move from an object like the breath or maybe a person we've brought to mind in the metta bhavana and the specific sensations arising in response to that person, to a breath, yeah? So from focused awareness, directing, attending, to just opening out and kind of resting back in a broad, open, warm, welcoming, curious awareness, where all of what's coming and going in six senses is free to pass through. And then, of course, we know that when we open in that way, certain things that arise might hook us, yeah? So a particularly intoxicating thought pattern or a habitually, a sensation in the body that we habitually privilege. And that can go either way. That could be a place where we often experience pain. It could also be a place where we often experience pleasure. Or it might be a place of numbness. And again, there's nothing wrong with any of that, but it's more like, can we know what we're doing? So are we doing it in the service of the practice and liberating ourselves, or is it just a habit to go there and sort of stay there? And what would it be like then to notice that? Oh, that's also an arising. The habit is also an arising, coming and going in awareness, and we can notice that habit. And in that moment, brought in. And notice how that habit just self-liberates on its own. If there's enough stability of mind that we're not completely, you know, it's not like this. I know both Mani Garba and Mumukshu are on this retreat, and we had the privilege of being together on a team on a retreat a few years ago. And this happens often on retreats, like there's certain images or metaphors that kind of stick. And one of them was like this octopus that just kind of sticks to your face. Of course, it was Viveka leading that retreat. And she I can't remember when, but I think that the community gifted her a stuffed animal octopus so we could actually have a visual. Yeah. So when we don't have an octopus stuck to our face, then we can, we've just got the ocean. Yeah, the whole of the ocean, full of a diversity of living things. So I just wanted to share a couple of images. These will be familiar to many of you, very traditional from the Mahamudra tradition. So Mahamudra means great gesture, great symbol. And this is the tradition that our just sitting practice comes from. So one is, and we've already brought it into the retreat, so it's just a reminder, really. One is just noticing that in the resting back, it's a bit like we're sitting on a beach watching the ocean. And rather than focusing on just like one wave, we're just taking it all in. And when we take it all in, we notice the beautiful, ever-changing, magical display of waves coming into form and then dissolving. you know, foaminess, frothiness, places, you know, different changing colors on the surface of the water, green, blue, white, yellow. The different way the light catches, you know. Ooh, there's a lot of octopi there, Manikarpa. I hope that's not a visual of your mind this morning. It's a community, isn't it? A community of octopi. One for each sense door. The wholeness of experience. So in just sitting, if you notice you're sort of getting locked into something, remembering this image of the ocean can be really helpful. Like, oh yeah, it's as if the whole of my being is that ocean, and all of these waves can just come and go as they are with all their distinctions, their uniqueness. Each wave, a unique phenomenon, never to be repeated. So that's one metaphor. And then another one is imagining that all of what's coming and going, and in particular, this can be helpful with pesky thoughts, are just like cows in a field. So you're just giving them, you know, when we're in the thought, maybe the cow is like really locked into a very small enclosure. So we're giving them a really big space to just do what they need to do, run around, frolic, eat some grass. Lay down for a while, have a rest, scratch their necks on the fence, whatever they need to do. Okay, so I think that's enough words for now. So I'll lead us in a consortium. Oh, nice, I like that. Thanks, dear Mitra. A consortium of octopus, I like that. So yeah, as always, come up with your own language that works for you to describe these dynamics. So setting yourself up in a posture that feels good, it's going to be supportive to you. And what we'll do is we'll begin with a beautiful reading from Padmasambhava's Self-Liberation Through Naked Awareness. And if you're not familiar with Padmasambhava, he was an 8th century practitioner who is partially credited with bringing Buddhism from India to Tibet. And we're going to bring him in much more fully this in the late session today. And then I'll just gently guide us. And what I'll do is I'll start with sort of just inviting us to notice what's happening in each sense door, and then we'll just open to the fullness of what's here. So here we go. Padmasambhava. From self-liberation through seeing with naked awareness. Now, when you are introduced to your own intrinsic awareness, the method for entering into it involves three considerations. Thoughts in the past are clear and empty and leave no traces behind. Thoughts in the future are fresh and unconditioned by anything. And in the present moment, when your mind remains in its own condition, without constructing anything, awareness at that moment in itself is quite ordinary. And when you look into yourself in this way, nakedly, without any discursive thoughts, since there is only this pure observing, there will be found a lucid clarity without anyone being there who is the observer. Only a naked, manifest awareness is present. This awareness is empty and immaculately pure, not being created by anything whatsoever. It is authentic and unadulterated, without any duality of clarity and emptiness. It is not permanent, and yet it is not created by anything. However, it is not a mere nothingness or something annihilated, because it is lucid and present. It does not exist as a single entity, because it is present and clear in terms of being many. On the other hand, it is not created as a multiplicity of things, because it is inseparable and of a single flavor. This inherent self-awareness does not derive from anything outside itself. This is the real introduction to the actual condition of things. So if it's helpful, just beginning with three deep breaths here. Making any sounds that feel good on the out breath. And finding that always present support of the ground. Allowing the weight of the body to drop down into the earth, be held here. While the upper body rises into space. Or if you're laying down, the whole front of the body opening to the sky. Soft and receptive. Starting with just noticing sounds. The rich soundscape of here and now. Rising and passing, like waves on the ocean surface. Noticing the arising and passing of smells. And taste. could swallow to get a sense of taste. Visual sensations with the eyes closed, there can still be a sense of light, color, shadow, form. And you can also play around with opening the eyes. So if you open the eyes, the instruction is to remain soft in the gaze. So you're just as aware of the center as the periphery. Aware of physical sensations in the body coming and going. Having a broad sense of the whole body. From the core all the way out to the edges. A rich, dynamic tapestry of sensation coming and going. So here we're learning to trust in an awareness that can receive and hold sensations for as long as they last. An open, deeply sensitive awareness where all can be known clearly as it is. Like a mirror. And then we're just going to notice here if there's some even quite subtle ways that we're layering thought on top of direct experience. So maybe you've got an image of the body or words to describe what's happening. I just want to invite you to see what it's like to peel back those layers, kind of like taking a sticker off something. And just revealing the raw, direct experience as it is in awareness. I want to invite you now to also open to a heart mind, chitta. In the same way we've been opening to the other five senses. So all the activity of the mind can also come and go, just like sounds, just like smells, tastes, visual sensations, physical sensations. Coming into form seemingly out of nowhere and dissolving back into emptiness. If you find this a little bit tricky, I have a couple of tips here. So one thing we can get curious about is the quality of the formations rather than their content. We're so often drawn into the content, into the story, the narrative. So here we can notice whether a thought, for example, has a heaviness or a lightness to it, a speed, even a direction of travel through the space of the mind, a duration, how long it lasts. You might even have a sense of an echo in the body. Maybe some thoughts bring on a sense of heaviness, contraction, others have more expansive, softening sensation to it. So we'll just spend a little bit of time getting curious about the qualities of what's arising and passing in the heart mind. A bit like watching the uniqueness of each wave, how it forms, how it dissolves. We can apply the same reflection to emotions. So maybe some thoughts come with a bit of irritation or confusion, excitement, even joy. Might be aware of felt sense of certain emotions in the body. So again, rather than getting caught up in labels, narratives, stories, what's it like to just open to the raw sensation of the emotion, however it's presenting energetically, however it's moving through you? What happens? How is it? Even the subtle energy of intoxication with thought might have a energy in the body that can be self-liberated in awareness. simply allowing. The last 6 minutes of this practice, just inviting an opening now to all six senses, the fullness of experience, life living through you, sounds, sights, smells, tastes, physical sensations, thoughts, emotions. This might be a time to experiment with eyes open if you haven't already. You might even want to put the hands palm up in the lap. A mudra of openness and receptivity. Just sitting. Completely open. Being with. So in a minute, I'll ring a bell to mark the end of this period of just sitting. the bell is just a symbol, doesn't really mean anything. Awareness continues to roll on. So the invitation is to transition into possibly taking care of yourself in some way, and also just continuing to notice in a warm, open way. And if you'd like, during the break, feel free to drop anything you noticed during the practice in the chat.
Hello, welcome back, everybody. I was just really enjoying reading all the comments there, all the different noticings and senses, external senses, impressions and stories and such. And yeah, very rich. And I just got caught up in one of my stories. The thought came up, I haven't got my queso on, and the thought was believed, and then drove some behaviour of looking in my drawers and on my desk and thinking, where on earth has that queso gone? You know, has the cat gone off of it in its mouth? Or and then as I was looking, I saw in my field of view something white around my neck, and I realised that I had it on. A whole kind of conditioned pattern of behaviour there. So good. So thank you, Singhashri, for that evocation of just sitting in many different ways. I'll guide us briefly into the just sitting practice in a bit. I'm just going to say a few things. Sometimes it's called the no method, just sitting, the no method method. I mentioned on Padlet, somebody's very helpfully made some comments around anger, you know, following my input last night. And I said on Padlet that I'd just briefly touch into that in this first session. And it really does, it's very much in the spirit of just sitting, what I'll say, really. So it kind of applies to all emotions, really. The issues around allowing anger its space, you know, allowing anger its space. And what does that mean to allow anger its space? So, again, I thought I'd just maybe... put the ideal into imagery, you know, and acknowledging that this is a kind of gradual practice and a gradual process, you know. So the image that came was a volcano, you know, and that inevitably in life, you know, things will happen which evoke a response of anger, you know, and I know in myself that there can be a knee-jerk kind of pushing down or closing against a feeling of anger, you know. That's like sometimes you can see that as like some ice. You're trying to ice the top of the volcano. You're trying to put a kind of ice cap on the volcano to sort of depress the feeling. And, you know, depressing feelings often leads to depression, you know, and so often in my experience, depression is driven by depressed anger. You know? So it's a good word, really. So we might try and smile over, you know, an interaction, you know, while sort of the body is kind of tense and things. not a very good strategy. You know, one aspect is that, you know, lava melts ice, you know, so the pressure can tend to build up and then suddenly you just kind of, it just sort of explodes, you know. So that's one poll. Yeah, thanks, Boogs. just switching metaphors. It's like pushing down a beach ball underwater. You know, it takes a lot of effort, you know. And in the other poll, and to continue with the volcano metaphor, is that we actually, instead of depressing it and trying to push it away, we actually kind of dive into it, you know. We actually kind of just say, well, I'm going to completely immerse myself in the volcano. I'm going to become the volcano. I'm going to be only volcano, you know. So we've got one arising in one of the senses here. And then we think, right, that's me. You know, just kind of immersing ourselves in it. And, you know, the Buddha talks about what we dwell on, we become. You know, so we energize the volcano through that, really. We're just its stories, you know. And that tends to kind of like, you know, it's like a switching metaphors again, but like a snowball going down a slope. It just gets bigger and bigger, you know, and it's running away with itself. And that's the kind of, maybe the spitting out of rocks to people around us and the flames and the shoots of lava and, you know, in the paddler, you know, the comment about, you know, the raging partner, you know, that's the kind of example of just like, just shooting out in all directions. But the Buddha taught the middle way, you know, between denial and intoxication. So fortunately, there's a way out of this. There's another option, really. So for me, what came around that was just kind of you're actually bodily, not as an idea, you're bodily in touch with the quality and texture of that anger. So you feel its strength and power. You might get a sense of what it wants to do in and of itself. You know, does it want to kind of hit? Does it want to bite? Does it want to push? You know, tune into its intention. You might be able to tolerate some of its charge. And it has some space to kind of do its thing, you know. But we haven't lost that there's a lot else going on around it. You know, part of us is aware that actions have consequences. There's all the land around the volcano and there's the sky above it, you know, so it's just one aspect. It's being held in a much bigger space of kind of awareness and things, a broader awareness. And that can give choice, you know. And I think there's something really interesting about our agency, because there's something that the anger is giving us. It's kind of telling us that there's something important here that's being crossed or not right. So it's a messenger. But it's also, there's something around the energy of that anger when it's held, when we've got a broader, we're connected with our broader sense of ourselves, other parts of us, is it can give kind of confidence to set boundaries, you know, to say no, to stand up to our values and to meet others' energy, you know. So there's something about that middle way that just offers a lot, you know, where we kind of stay connected with all of us, and that includes the anger, you know. So if we just kind of broaden that out to just sitting. I mean, Singhashri was talking quite a lot about this earlier, wasn't she, about the six senses, you know, and our six senses, one way that comes for me around this is that our six senses are constantly pulsating with energy and life, you know. We are pulsations of energy. I'm a pulsation of energy at the moment, And I'm looking out on the visual field, and you are all pulsations of energy, you know. So if some of you started, how I am now, how you're pulsating is conditioning how I'm pulsating, you know. It's, and we are co-creating each other, you know. There's other aspects co-creating me now, like the temperature in the room, the fact that I haven't got somebody loudly cutting their hedge next door. That would be a pulsation of energy that would be conditioning me here. And the fact that you're not picking up a book, you know, and reading a book or yawning or seeming really distracted is a pulsation of energy that's conditioning me now, you know. So it's so, we're such of this, you know, we talked about the community of the energies in the body, but we're also in this field, which is such a co-creating kind of space with all this complexity and richness and mystery that's so beyond the idea of the little stories that we have about ourselves. You know, I'm this, I'm that, you know, that puts us into little kind of boxes. So, and there's something about the more that we see the pulsation or the impermanence, the more we become present and see what's actually happening. That's like a gateway into the qualities of the sky, you know, or this ocean of being, switching metaphors. You know, that all of this is happening in the vast open sky-like mind, you know, and I think it's through seeing and feeling the impermanence. But then it starts to, this feels like it's all arising in a much bigger open empty space of awareness, and that awareness has these qualities, you know. Everything is arising in the big mind, and this space has qualities, and they're one way of representing them is the bodhisattvas, you know, all these qualities of the bodhisattvas. So what I'd like us to do now, we're just going to use the there's things we can't do because we're not in person, but there's things like we can't have lunch together or dinner together. We're in different time zones as well, but there's things we can do here that it's hard to do on in person. So what I'd like to do now is just for you to watch a 2-minute video. So we're just going to just watch a 2-minute video, and I'm going to make myself go quiet. Great, thank you. So let's from there go into just sitting, or continue in just sitting, perhaps, but just sitting quietly. So we are always, we can't be anything other than in and of sky. Even efforting arises in the sky and is of the sky. It's an empty nature to it. An appearance like a rainbow or the moon reflected on water. Not really, not there, but also there. Existence, non-existence, neither applies, mystery. We tend to be addicted to solidity, so we imagine solidity. Where there is just empty appearance. So I'm just going to give a brief entry to just sitting. We have a sense of the pulsation in our senses. This flow of life. It's very easy in life to feel that there's just fireworks, there's just appearances. But it's all happening in a vast formless dimension of awareness, and is of awareness. So there's something here we can fall back into, which is a no thing. But tangibly present. Arisings and passings. And that which knows the arising and passing is the sky. life flowing through us. Constant change. Irritation, dullness, boredom, excitement, joy, planning, fantasies, all manifesting in the vast, open, empty space of sky-like mind. So in a minute I'll ring the gong. To mark the end of this sit. And then we'll just have a few minutes together, just in open space, if there's any sharing of what was noticed. So here we are. Yes, I just wanted to just open things up a bit here and just give an opportunity to reflect on your practice then. And if you wanted to share anything that you noticed as you were sensitive to your firework displays, in the chat, or if anybody wanted to speak and be spotlighted, or to speak and not be spotlighted, this is a space just for a few minutes. And yeah, if we keep it quite experiential, you know, really what was going on in your six senses, what did you notice about mind and body?
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Balajit, and Singhashri, and everybody.
Thank you.
See you later.
Thank you both for a great session. See you later.